Well, good evening and welcome and thank you for being here today. I'm going to introduce you to one of the most representative chamber music compositions of Claude Debussy, the Sonata for Flute, Viola and Harp, and its influence in the viola repertoire. For a long time, the chamber music repertoire that includes viola was mainly the string quartet and the piano duet. Debussy, well known for his revolutionary compositional techniques, opening a new perspective by using an uncommon ensemble. In my research process, I was fortunate to find publications of Debussy's letters, as well as dissertations and theses focused on the sonata with a theoretical and historical approach, articles in different musical magazines, and Debussy manuscript in the public domain. I had the opportunity to connect the composer with other arts, including poetry and painting, understand it that from his point of view, every art is an inspiration in the creation of a new one. And finally, I also explore how this work influenced other genres such as jazz. Claude Debussy was born on August 22 of 1862 in Saint-Germain-en-Laye in the northern part of Paris. Originally from a modest family, Debussy's grandfather was a wine merchant and later a carpenter. His father, Manuel Arcai, served in the Marine Corps for 7 years, then moved to Saint-Germain with his wife, Victorine Monroe, to run a China shop. Claude was the firstborn of five children, although his baptism was 2 years later. The unsuccessful business forced the family to move to Paris. Due to financial reasons, Victorine entrusted all her children, except Claude, to the care of her sister-in-law. Claude never went to school. His mother taught him to read and write. But his education was far from complete. After the unfortunate death of his brother, Eugene, by meningitis, he moved with his sister to Caen's, where his aunt encouraged him to begin piano lessons from an old Italian teacher named Ceruti. At the age of 10, he was admitted to the Paris Conservatory, where according to Edward Lockspear, his awkward and unsociable manner, not to mention his poor education, hardly made him attractive to his fellow students. In 1872, Claude Debussy began his studies at the Conservatory, where he remained for almost 20 years. His first enrollment was in the solfège class with Professors Albert Levinot and piano with Professor Antoine Marmottiel. Featuring the solfège class, obtaining the first prize of the class, and not so much in piano, made him give up the idea of being a piano virtuoso. He enrolled also in Augustin Basile's accompaniment class and Emily Duro harmony class, in which he won his only primer prize or high honor diploma in musical studies at the conservatory. The last class that Debussy took at the conservatory was Ernest Guiraud's compositional class, whose music attracted him for his certain liberal-mindedness and harmonic tolerance flow. I call it brain freedom. Debussy called it Le Regard de l'œil, the feast of hearing. Claude Debussy alternated his career between composing and piano accompaniment. In 1880, he met the patroness of Tchaikovsky, Nadezhda von Meck, for whom he worked for a long time, playing certain scores of Tchaikovsky's work and teaching her sons piano lessons. Some of the letters of Madame von Marck to Tchaikovsky reflect her appreciation for this little Frenchman, as she called him with love. She presented some of the early works of Debussy to Tchaikovsky in a search for feedback for her little friend. Debussy traveled to Russia in July of 1881 for 2 months, where he spent time with Madame von Marck's family, and his music was influenced by Balakirev, Korsakov, Borodin, Mussorgsky, and Tchaikovsky. After finishing his studies at the conservatory, he won the Prix in Rome in January of 1885 with his cantata L'Enfant Prodige. His life in Rome turned out to be against his will. In some of his letters to Monsieur Baxier, one of his few friends, he expressed his nonconformity with the environment in Rome. From one of his letters, "This artistic atmosphere and camaraderie that we are told about seems to be very exaggerated. With one or two exceptions, it is difficult to talk with the people here, And when I hear their ordinary conversations, I cannot help thinking of the fine talks that we used to have, which opened my mind to many things. Then, the people here are very egoistic. I hear the musicians demolishing each other. I try to work, but I can't. You know how much I love music and how much this state of mind annoys me. This is not the life for me. Their happiness isn't mine. It's not pride that makes me hate this life. I can't get used to it. I have no feeling for it, and I don't have the necessary indifference. After 2 years of living in Rome at the Villa Medici, he came back to Paris in 1887. The next years include new influences over his art. Also, in 1887, he traveled to Vienna to meet Brahms. After a letter and answer and two calls to his house with unsuccessful results, he had the fortune to be held by an old pupil of Brahms, the wife of one of the secretaries in the French embassy, that may launch with the master possible. This experience brought Debussy to know about Brahms' passion for Bizet and his recent work Carmen. Also, together they visit the graves of Beethoven and Schubert. In 1888 and 1889, Debussy attended the Bayreuth Festival performances of Parsifal, Meistersinger, and Tristan and Isolde. As a young musician, he admired Wagner's works. He spent time analyzing the score of Tristan and Isolde in search of the new tonal language. But not a long time passed until he realized that the German influence was too far from what French music and art meant. Lockspierre described this moment as the cult of Wagner, dominating the entire world of literature and art. Leon Balas, in his book, The Theories of Claude Debussy, compiled interviews that make clear Debussy's opinion about Wagner's music. One of the most assertive comments was made to a journalist in 1909, when Debussy said, "Wagner's genius is certainly unquestionable. Wagner has above all created an art which is individual to him, and those who came to his influence have taken only his form. It is his drama, above all, that is false from our French point of view." Another influence in Debussy's musical life was his relationship with one of the most original French composers at the time, Erik Satie, who kept the opera comique alive while the world was delighted by the influence of Wagner. Debussy met him in 1891, and in one of his lectures referring to Debussy, Satie said, "I explained to Debussy the need a Frenchman has to free himself from the Wagnerian venture, which did not respond to our natural aspirations. I also point out that I was in no way anti-Wagnerian, but that we should have music of our own. Why could we not use the means that Claude Monet, Cézanne, Toulon Lautrec, and others had made known?" Possibly Satie was one of the main influences in Debussy's development. Some scholars attribute the use of unresolved nines in Debussy's scores as a theoretical legacy to Satie. The next years, from 1890 to 1914, are called the Bohemian and Symbolist years by François Le Chieur in his article about Debussy in the Grove Music Dictionary. It was the beginning of a new perspective from the time spent in the literary and artistic cafes where the symbolists gathered. Symbolism was a late 19th century art movement of French, Russian, and Belgian origin in poetry and other arts, seeking to represent absolute truth symbolically through metaphorical images and language, mainly as a reaction against naturalism and realism. Symbolists believe that art should represent absolute truths that could only be described indirectly. This was the moment that Debussy, nonconformity with the social music world, brought him to explore other kinds of arts, mainly literature and poetry. Since Debussy scholars are to beg, it was a period during which artists in all fields were reaching out in new directions, seeking guidance for other arts. Some of the most important libraries and cafes at that time were Library de l'Art Independent, Taverne Bever, and Mardi chez Mallarmé. These important places permit Debussy establish new artistic collections, for example, Villiers de Lay, author of Axel, a play for which Debussy composed incidental music in 1889. Henri de Regnier, a poet who influenced Debussy nocturnes and prose lyrics. Pierre Louis, the poet, one of his closest friends. Cathalie Mende, a poet who collaborated with the unsuccessful opera Rodriguez Ximene. Francis Bill Griffin, a publisher of Debussy's poems. And Valerie Valéry, a poet and author of Monsieur Tristet, character that influenced Debussy's Monsieur Cruchet, his pseudonym in The Journalist. Influenced by the power of poetry, Debussy wrote a large number of pieces with descriptive titles, including names of poems, or lines of poems, or other references from literature. Also, he wrote a considerable number of poems of his own, and delighted in the use of rhetorical tools such as the onomatopoeia. His major influence came from Théodore de Bambule, Charles Baudelaire, Paul Valéry, Stéphane Mallarmé, Maurice Maeterlinck, Edgar Allan Poe, and his close friend Pierre Louis. His passion for literature also brought him to the world of journalism, writing for La Revue Blanche under the pseudonym Monsieur Cochot. He also served as a critic for Gil Blas and La Revue SAM. The years from 1893 to 1902 are attributed by scholars as the Peleas years, influenced by the drama of Maeterlinck, Peleas et Melisande. Debussy decided to use the text as part of his new opera of the same name. He spent a period of 9 years working on this project. During this period, his personal life involved a long relationship with Gabriel Dupont and a financial stability working with Ernest Chausson. Some of his extra work, parallel to composing, include performances of piano reductions of Wagner operas, including Parsifal and Tristan et Isolde. Debussy finished the first version of Peleas et Melisande in 1895. The production was possible with the sponsorship of George Hartmann, a publisher who believed strongly in Debussy's talent and paid him money as a support of his career. After a lot of attempts, the premiere took place in 1902 in the Salle Lafayette in Paris. In these years, Debussy also made his first appearance in the Parisian Artistic Society with the performance of La Demoiselle and the premiere of his string quartet led by Isaïe. Other important works include the premiere of the orchestra triptych Nocturnes in 1897, based on some poems by Henri Regnier, and a musical contribution based on the poem L'Apprendimenti du Fauno, commissioned by Mallarmé in 1890. Results came years later with the well-known Prelude. In 1903, Debussy decides to compose a new triptych for orchestra, one of his most remarkable compositions, La Mer, described for him as 3 symphonic sketches. Scholar Léon Ballas assured his readers that this work harkens back to the classical tradition associated with the all 3 movements, symphony structure, allegro, scherzo, and finale, a radical assumption for other scholars. Unlike symphonies of old, the harmony is surrounded by strategic embellishments. In 1908, he made his debut as a conductor with La Mer. Locke Spears compares the importance of La Mer for Debussy as the 5th symphony for Beethoven. Unfortunately, the first years of performance of this composition were not the best, as the public was reluctant to embrace Debussy's innovations, and it was not until the Toscanini performances in the 1930s, more than 20 years later, that the world understood the genius of Debussy. Debussy's personal life was controversial for his time. The long relationship with Gabriel Dupont finished after the unfortunate finding of a letter that clearly involved Claude Debussy in an affair with Rosalie Textier, who became his wife in the next few years. In the summer of 1904, his relationship status changed again when he decided to marry Madame Bardac, leaving Rosalie Textier, or Lily Debussy, as she likes to be called, in a depressive state that led her to a suicide attempt. The new relationship with Madame Bardac brought him a daughter in the summer of 1905 named Claude Emma. He called her Chuchu. The next years came with new projects. In 1909, Debussy was invited to be part of the main board of the conservatory. It was also the year of his first book of preludes and of writing incidental music for Le Martin de Saint-Sébastien, a mystery in five acts by Gabriel D'Annunzio, commissioned by the dancer Ida Rubinstein. In 1912, he received a request from Diaghilev of a poem dance called Yux, with the choreography of Nijinsky. The premiere was overshadowed by Stravinsky's Rite of Spring during the same week. Debussy started to write reviews again in 1913, this time for the revue musicale CM. This year also wrote his second book of preludes, his ballet for children, and the three poems of Mallarmé. Debussy's last years were affected by the beginning of the World War I, and a notable depression due to the diagnosis of rectal cancer. In 1915, he decided to move away from Paris to Porville. This was the period of the three sonatas, written between 1915 and 1917. Originally planned as a part of a series of six sonatas for various combinations of instruments. The first is for cello and piano, the second for harp, viola, and flute, and the third one is for violin and piano. In May of 1917, he appeared on a concert platform in Paris for the last time. At the beginning of 1918, he was confined to his house, and in the evening of March 25, he died. Louis Lalo, a close friend of Debussy and his first biographers, wrote about the funeral. "I can see, as in a bad dream, the coffin near the piano and the musicians in their soldiers' uniforms. The door kept on opening and closing, and there was no more room for the flowers. The Minister of Education took his place at the head of the procession. Side by side, in front of me, the conductors of our great philharmonic societies, Camille Chevillon and Gabriel Pionnet, worked in silence. All those concerts in which they had taken care of his music are over. The sky was overcast. There was a rumbling in the distance. Was it the storm or the explosion of a shell? Along the wide avenues, there was nothing to be seen but military trucks. The people on the pavements pressed ahead hurriedly, but there was still a bustle in the populous uphill streets of Montmartre. The children made way and stood on a line in the gutter and stared at us. The shopkeepers questioned each other at their doors and glanced at the streamers on the grates. It seems he was a musician, they say." Debussy's musical legacy brings the term Debussyism on the table, first used by composer Alexis Roland-Manuel with the sentence, "We are forever Debussyism," referring to the high influence of Debussy in the pre-war and post-war French composers. Some journalists, as Jacques Riverier, use the term Debussyism to talk about composers influenced by Debussy and anti-Debussyism to the ones barely influenced. One of the main examples of composers' anti-Debussyism is Stravinsky. Debussy is also considered one of the precursors of the jazz language, being the first classical composer that incorporated ragtime in his music. Debussy's Golden Cakewalk, written for his daughter Chouchou, is a ragtime in classical terms. Some scholars attribute anticipation of jazz in the third movement of La Mer. Additionally, the new harmonic structures, including octatonic scales, modal techniques, and use of non-functional chords, are characteristics of posterior jazz artists such as Django Reinhardt, Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Parker, Thelonious Monk, Miles Davis, Bill Evans, among others. After this overview of Debussy's life and different influences, I want to introduce to you some important concepts and innovations in his compositional style. Debussy established a new musical perspective with his conception of music as a free art. To understand Debussy's concept, I want to read from one of his letters, The Meaning of Music. "Music is a mysterious form of mathematics whose elements are derived from the infinite. Music is the expression of the movements of the waters, the play of curves described by changing breezes. There is nothing more musical than a sunset. He who feels what he sees will find no more beautiful example of development In all that book, which allies musicians read but too little, the book of nature. In the mouth of Monsieur Cruchot, music is the sum total of scattered forces, and people have made a song composed of theories. I prefer a few notes from the flute of an Egyptian shepherd. He collaborated with the scenery around him and hears harmonies of which our textbooks are ignorant. Musicians listen only to music written by skillful hands. They never heard what is written in nature. There is more to be gained by seeing the sunrise than by hearing the pastoral symphony. To musicians, it is given to capture all the poetry of night and day, of earth and heaven, to reconstruct their atmosphere and record the rhythm of their great heartbeats. Music shall humble seek to please, above all to give pleasure. Debussy made clear that to him music is the expression of feelings and emotions. It is a gift that musicians have to recreate feelings that the common man cannot even understand. His interest in the meaning of beauty and deep human expressions brought him to explore poetry as one of the most refined arts, with the capability to see further in expression than in technique. Debussy was one of the main exponents of musical impressionism, though the term impressionism was highly rejected by him. Instead, he called himself a symbolist for his relationship with the literary movement. The term impressionism is borrowed from the late 19th century paintings, originated from Monet's Impression, Sunrise, painted in 1873. To understand the concept, remember that in the Romantic era, the origin of a composition came from an individual who had certain feelings and who was affected in a direct way. The impressionist perspective comes from outside. The creator is a spectator of the affected human. The matter is the perception of the emotion, not the emotion as it is. The development of Debussy's musical language is divided in three periods. The first one, where he tried to move away from salon music to a more serious style, highlighting clear melodies, long lyrical lines, and still a sense of tonality. The second period is the Impressionist time, the longest period of his life influenced by the symbolist movement, characterized by dramatic harmonic changes, the use of ninths, elevenths, and thirteenths in non-functional chords, unresolved cadences, and the use of whole tone pentatonic and octatonic scales. He explored bitonality and atonality, searching for rich dissonances. He used harmony as a dimension of melody instead of accompaniment. He used the French language as a reference for rhythm, character, accent, and length of sound. He created new orchestral textures with muted strings, non-heroic brass, delicate percussion sounds, and extensive use of harp. In the last period, he moved away from impressionism and focused on a more textural and formal simplicity. The use of poems as titles of his music disappeared, and he came back to the traditional titles used in his youth. The techniques now focus on numerous variations, repetitions, cyclic themes, motif developments, and overlapping motifs and ideas. The mood in his late works is melancholy and expressive, animated and bitter, the extremes of human expressions. Ava Sommer, in his study of Debussy's sonatas, points out how the composer's flexible approach to phrasing and harmony produces a sense of general ambiguity, a sentiment inherent in symbolism. In one of his letters, Debussy expressed how he intended to use the quote in Le Diable dans le Bois, an opera based on a novel by Edgar Allan Poe that he never completed. He stated that he wishes to compose something incoherent in appearance, but fundamentally ordered, in which every voice was independent while producing an expression of unity. This is exactly what he achieved with his second sonata. The second sonata for flute, viola, and harp, that is the Mahler this lecture, was composed in Debussy's last period. It was finished between September and October of 1915. Dedicated to his wife, Emma Burdock, premiering formally in November 7 of 1916 in the Lunge Club in Boston, and formally in February 2 of 1917 at London's Aeolian Hall. But Debussy was in neither of them. Based on Carl Swanson's articles in the American Harp Journal, Debussy worked closely with the trio of Pierre Jamin, a talented harpist that studied in the Paris Conservatory, flutist Albert Manoubrier, and violist Sigismond Jarecki. Debussy invited the trio to perform the sonata at one of the concerts that he was organizing to benefit the Betteme Tubles organization. The performance took place at Laurent, a restaurant on the Champs-Élysées on March 20 of 1970. The second sonata was originally for flute, oboe, and harp. The decision to change the oboe for viola does not have a clear explanation in any of Debussy's letters, but in my personal opinion, thank you, Debussy. According to James Coller on his Chamber Music Listener's Guide, the decision to substitute a viola for the oboe adds to the word refined, southerly, enlarging the timbral variety and providing a sonic middle ground. When bowed, the viola allies itself to the sustained notes of the flute. When played pizzicato, it reaches the plucked strings timbre of the harp. According to Lockspear, the longer and more elaborate second sonata is usually considered the work especially evocative of Couperin, though this classical grace and elegance are not in themselves the most enduring qualities of the work. In one of the letters, works of Debussy, is the significance more apparent of the beautiful dictum of Luc de Caplier's Marquess of Bouguardes. It is the clarity that reveals the deep to us. Indeed, the clarity and the merciless precision of detail in both the solo and the ensemble writing poignantly expressive that the composer was himself forced to declare in one of his letters to Robert Godet, that the music he has written was so terribly melancholic that I can't say whether one should love or cry, perhaps both. And he adds, the further I go, the more I horrify by a deliberate disorder, which is nothing but aural bluff, and also about those eccentric harmonics which amount to nothing by flirting with fashion. How much has to be explored and discarded before reaching the naked flesh of emotion? Debussy claimed that to understand a piece, it needs to be analyzed in its totality in order to appreciate its meaning. From my perspective, the cyclic form among the three movements, pastoral, interior, and final, could be the representation of his words. Additionally, the ensemble, flute, viola, and harp, seems to be a modern imitation to the trio sonata for French Baroque composers Couperin and Romain. The analysis of Debussy's work has been a major discussion between theorists. It is not as simple as to come back to the old French or to analyze critically each note as the tonal music permits. One of the analyses that I found that could most deeply explain this piece is in the form of narrative analysis. The purpose of this kind of analysis is to understand the plot of the piece from a narrative perspective. This concept is especially useful for the study of early post-tonal works. Vincent Dolay, in his dissertation, A Symbolist Interpretation of Narrative Time in Debussy's Sonata for Flute, Viola, and Harp, introduced a comparison between the narrative model of Gilles Dulieu, a French composer from the early 50s, that summarized the process through which human beings use their past experience, including three components. First, reminiscence, where a memory is recalled. Second, eternity, as an utopian attempt to keep a moment alive in the present. And third, regret, where the individual looks back to the past in longing. Leys compares the structure of the three movements of the sonata with the three components that Deleuze suggests about the analysis of one's life. Pastoral as the memory, interlude as the eternity, and final as acceptance and death. After the review of Debussy's life, from the perspective of Lockspear, and from Debussy's letters, the comparison that Leys proceeds could not be more assertive. The three periods of Debussy's life and musical development are unified on this sonata. The pastoral movement, or the movement of the reminiscence, is the most extended and structurally complex. Debussy imitates the Egyptian shepherd flute sonority and the use of pedal notes from the Renaissance organ music and world music. In my opinion, the general structure of this movement could be exemplified by a compound ternary form, ABC, D, CBA prime, giving the idea of a mirror. In the narrative perspective, this movement emulates the human mental process when it remembers something but comes back to the present. The first part, that includes the motifs ABC, shares the melody between the flute and the viola, creates an scenario of the present moment with a melancholic character. The middle part, motif D, is the memory. It begins with a solo viola. The character is joyful and excitement. Words as gracio, beef, and jokes appears on the score. Clearly, it's a contrast from the mood of the first part. Additionally, it's the first time that the harp has the melody and the viola and flute recreate the atmosphere that the harp had before. The melody comes back to the viola and flute, but this time as an unisono that announces the return to the tempo primo. Finally, the third part, motifs CVA prime, is a representation of the first part with the motifs in an inverse wave. The introduction theme is presented at the end, imitating the composer coming back to the present. The pastoral movement finishes with a pedal note on C, the same pedal of the beginning of the second movement. In my perspective, it connects the first movement with the second. The interlude of the moment of eternity features lyrical lines and a clear ABA form. Enharmonic colors as presented at the emphasis of G flat in the A section and F sharp in the B section, where the same sonority strategically controls bright and dark colors. The main theme is repeated 7 times in the movement, but each of them have different expression markings, such as dolce simplice, molto sensibile, suspirare, and dolce tristemente. In the narrative analysis, eternity is one of the main desires of the human being. Debussy's legacy is an example of eternity. Possibly, the repetition of the theme in this moment represents each time that the musical world comes back to Debussy's music. The different expression marks for the same theme could represent the different points of view that every interpreter has of the same. The final movement, finale, is the shorter in ternary form, featuring animated and brilliant movements and in this reminiscence of conclusive movements of the 18th century sonatas. The beginning of this movement is one of the most tense movements of the sonata. While the harp plays an ostinato, the flute and viola have a contrasting conversation instead of the continuous melody of the other movements. The use of rhythmic ostinato is part of the whole movement. The use of rubatos, retardandos, stringendos, and accelerandos creates the illusion of constant movement, similar to ocean waves. Also, words such as agitato and marcato appear repeatedly, keeping the character anxious and excited. From the narrative perspective, this movement represents the acceptance of the final destination of every human being, death. In my perspective, the continuous rhythm ostinato represents the train of life. Nearing to the end, the movement, the composer remembers the main theme of the pastoral movement, or in the narrative terms, the memory of his life. But in the train keeps going, and the composer arrives at his final destination with a short note in unison. But how does sonata have a huge influence in the viola repertoire? The history of the viola is uncommon for its lack of tradition compared to other instruments such as the violin or the flute. For a long time, the viola's job was mainly accompaniment. Before the Romantic era, only a few selected composers, such as Mozart and Rolla, saw the different side of the instrument by giving it a solo role. This factor delayed the development of a proper technique for the instrument, and for a long time, it was attached to violin technique as a larger twin. But it is now well understood that the proportion of the instruments required a different approach. For a long time, the quality of the performance was not the best, and this also limited the enthusiasm of composers to write for viola. The awakening moment of the viola as a primary instrument was during the Romantic period, when composers began to search for a sound that represents human nature and a deep range of emotions. They were highly influenced by the development of other arts, such as literature, poetry, and philosophy. It is important to highlight the influence of this period because suddenly more composers found a big interest in the viola as a melodic vessel. For so long, composers saw the viola as an accompaniment instrument to connect texture, harmony, and sonority. The Romantic period saw the instrument in a different way, with the small solos begin to appear in string quartets and orchestral works. Composers such as Mendelssohn, Brahms, and Schumann believe in the viola as a new storyteller accompanied with the piano. Some of the early repertoire with these inclinations are the two sonatas for viola and piano by Johannes Brahms, Mahenbilda by Robert Schumann, the American Quartet by Dvorak, and the famous solo in Richard Strauss' symphonic poem, Don Quixote. Debussy continued his legacy, and though his Impressionist language opened a new door to the development of the viola with his second sonata for flute, viola, and harp. Debussy's extended vocabulary in representation of colors and articulations demands a high technique from the interpreter, including aspects of sound production, management of different contact points, use of natural and false harmony, and comfortable left hand position and diversity of bow strokes. A Happy Life, in his article in Strad magazine, remembered how the topic of color was not always in the musicians' conversations, not until Debussy revolutionized the language of music. With an analogy, Pillay described the complexity of this piece. At a distance, the great masterworks of Monet possesses a simple and effortless beauty, as does this great sonata of Debussy. But as one draws closer to the picture and the score, one sees to how complex are the brushstrokes and how detailed are Debussy's indications regarding specific colors. For string players, our palette is provided by a series of technical tools, such as variations of bow speed, the contact point with the string, the angle of bow hair use, the type of bow stroke, the speed of vibrato, and fingerings. I want to introduce some of the main examples that represent the variety of colors that Debussy used for the viola. First, the false harmonics. The string instruments have natural harmonics depending on the length of the strings, as false harmonics playing one finger at the real note and other finger as the harmonic. For example. These are excerpts from the sonata that are gonna exemplify what I'm saying. Debussy used different bow strokes and spiccato. Different bow strokes as spiccato, staccato, dutalong, that means on the frog, legato, among others. For example, going to the position of the mute in main themes. This is something that any other composer were using before, and especially in the viola. Additionally, to the instrument technical challenges, the performance practice of this piece is completely different to another chamber work that I have played before. The unconventional ensemble implies a different approach to music in general. Three vocabularies include breath for the flute, bow for the viola, and clapping for the harp. The main purpose of the viola is to connect the opposite textures of the flute's breath and the harp's blocks. The versatility of the viola allows the player to imitate the flute or the harp in order to blend them, as if to create one instrument. In contrast with old times where the viola's purpose was mainly accompaniment, the challenge of this piece is the constant switch between solist and accompaniment. Additionally, the natural colors of the three instruments need to blend into each other to, in a certain way, create new instruments. In my ensemble, we call this new instrument flola, harp, flute, and viola. One of the most notable techniques that Debussy used for this purpose was the clambark melody, or sound color melody, where the composer split a melody line among different instruments. The creation of the congruent line was the priority. Each instrument has equal responsibilities to be on the sonata. To find a balance, we analyzed in what parts our instruments were background as pedal notes, middle ground as rhythmic accompaniment, or foreground representing the principal melody. On many occasions, the responsibility was in one of our new instruments. For example, has been a huge inspiration for my musical life, mainly in times of uncertainty at this current world pandemic. It reminds me of the importance of art in our society, how music is an inherent form of expression. Debussy's meaning of music is a reminder that music is everywhere, not just in a paper. Debussy's life invites every artist to take risks and believe in the new. And Debussy's second sonata, with the uncommon ensemble, remind us that identity difference, new great ideas could be born. Thank you. Now we're gonna take like 2 minutes to just set us and do the performance. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.